begin the second half of the semester, or maybe a little bit more than the second half of the semester, but we're glad that you're here, and we're excited to finish this semester strong. And we're also excited this morning to resume the TFC Lenten journey that we began a number of weeks ago. And this today begins a part of that journey where we're going to focus on a particular kind of teaching series that will lead us up to the time of Easter. And it's a teaching series that focuses on Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount. So it's going to be a great, great time. And as we do so, here's the invitation. Remember what we're doing here. We're trying to faithfully and fruitfully prepare our hearts and our lives to celebrate the wonder of Easter together. And so this season of Lent is a time for us to allow the Holy Spirit to examine us in such a way so that He might prepare us to do that well. Before we left for spring break, we learned that the basis for doing this, as we abandon ourselves and give ourselves to the work of the Holy Spirit in this Lenten season, is to posture ourselves in the practice of prayer. So I'm going to ask you to stand this morning, and as we will do throughout the next couple of weeks, I want you to grab the hand of the person beside you, and let's posture ourselves in prayer this morning as Jesus taught His disciples to do and to pray with one another. Will you pray with me this morning? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Come on, ready? We're going to do it all at the same time. All right? That's called a curveball. My bad. Here we go. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let's worship this morning.
Good morning, TFC. We invite y'all to worship with us.
Need you, Lord, come find me, Holy Spirit, I've been walking through deserts, I need more of your presence, I'm weak, Savior, be my strength. Bringing me closer, your hand healing what's broken, my prayer, Father, meet me here. My life for all of your glory, your grace, let it surround me, let faith change the atmosphere.
Is done, and we rejoice in that this morning. Come
on. Hallelujah, death is done. All of hell is overcome. Jesus, you are alive.
restore my soul, revive my heart, renew my life in every part, reveal to me. Restore my soul, revive my heart, renew my life in every part, reveal to me.
Came to him, and he opened his mouth and he taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are those who are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You see, you are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. See, you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but they put it on a stand and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. See, I tell you this, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. May the Lord add his blessing upon the reading of his most holy word this morning.
Sing this out. Sing, I will kneel.
I will kneel in the dust at the foot of the cross where mercy paid for me. Where the wrath I deserved, it is gone, it is past. Your blood has hid it. Mercy, mercy, as endless as the sea. And I'll sing your hallelujah for all eternity. We will lift up the cup and the bread we will break, remembering your love.
So we were falling.
We were falling from grace, but you took all our shame and nailed it to a cross.
Say mercy.
Mercy. Mercy. Endless as the sea, and I sing your hallelujah for all eternity.
Come on, every voice.
We sing mercy, mercy, as endless as the sea. And I'll sing your hallelujah for all eternity.
Can we focus on that grace this morning? Reflect on him. Think nothing about anything else except for him and his love for us. And we reflect on him. Say, man, hey.
May I never lose the wonder, oh, the wonder. And may I never lose the wonder, oh, the wonder of your mercy. May I sing your hallelujah.
Jesus, we're so thankful for that mercy. Help us to never forget it, to continue remembering it day by day, and let it guide us to restore our soul that continues to get chipped off at by this fallen world. Lord, we look to you to sanctify us. We look to you to heal us, to lead us. And it's only by your love, by your amazing grace, and it's only things that you can do, Jesus. It's nothing that we can do. And so we give you honor and praise for that. Continue to work in us this morning. Us to learn what your spirit is teaching so they can walk out of here a little bit closer to you. We love you and pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right. Figured I'd sit down today, not because I'm tired, not because I need to use the bathroom. Need to hold it in, you know, don't get to go. I'm not doing it for that reason. I'm sitting down because, you know, I want this to be more of a conversation, although I'm not going to ask you a lot to respond when it comes to actually sharing answers. But I want this to be more of a conversation because this journey that we're on is not a journey where anybody on this stage stands and preaches to you and tells you what you need to do in order to allow God to examine your life and how you need to get right. This is a community journey where we're really seeking together to open our life together, yeah, individually, but also as a community, and to say, God, what ways do you want to reshape us? What ways do you want to remold us so that we can fully and faithfully prepare for the wonder of Easter? And so, if you will, I just want this to be a little bit more casual today because although I'm going to be preaching, I don't want it to be preachy. But I do want to invite you to listen intently, not just to what I've prepared for you, but really to what God wants to say to us this morning. And as we come to the conclusion of our time this morning, as we will for the next 4 weeks, the altars are out. The altars are open. And we're simply asking God to do something new and fresh in our midst that that really prepares us to celebrate the resurrection. Amen? So let's pray together as we begin our time. Heavenly Father, would you use your word this morning to quicken our hearts? Lord, would you come and by your spirit help to do the work in us that's necessary in order for us to be bona fide followers of you? Lord, we open ourselves to that examination, because we know that as we do so, and as we let you have your way in our lives, you will shape not only something new and fresh, but your beautiful kingdom vision in us. That's what we want. And so, Lord, come, do your work here in our midst this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, like you, I had the privilege of going to college on a Christian campus. And as you well know, there are good things and maybe some trying things that go along with that. You know, sometimes Christian colleges or Christian communities can be a little too rigid. You know what I mean? I'm sure some of you have some ideas about TFC when it comes to maybe certain areas of our life together where things are a bit too rigid. But, you know, I've also experienced Christian colleges, and I would say it was kind of my experience, but I see it in other kinds of Christian communities where it's not so much the rigidness that gives us difficulty, but our familiarity with the Christian life leading to kind of a life of complacency and a failure of nerve to maintain important community values, important community ethics. For example, I'll give you a little example here. Back in the 80s when I was in your seat, you know, Asbury University, then it was called Asbury College, there were lots of rules. There were lots of regulations, all for our good, of course. And, of course, there were some every once in a while that I just didn't understand. For example, if I got caught going to chapel or going to a class without a pair of socks, I would receive a demerit. How about that? Now, I was thinking about that this morning. Jason Jenkins, are you in the room? Asa Murley, are you in the room? Yeah, here you go, baby. Listen, you wouldn't have lasted for a week because you don't even wear shoes. You know what I'm saying? All right. But it was hard for me. It was this issue of you had to wear socks with your shoes. And that was the day and age. You'll remember this. You know, you'll remember this. That was the day and age when leather boat shoes were all the rage of fashion. You know what I'm saying? Penny loafers, all right? If you go back and see old pictures of Michael Jackson doing his thing on stage, you'll see that he always wore these penny loafers. And now, he did something a little bit different. He would wear socks with his, but everybody knew if you were really cool, you never wore socks with penny loafers. You never wore socks with leather boat shoes. It just wasn't natural. It wasn't good. It wasn't right. All right? It's just a fact of the matter. But, yep, if I got caught doing so, I'd get a demerit. And the more demerits I got, the more I got called into the Dean of Students to answer for my failure to live up to the Asbury Code and Standard. Right? You know what I'm talking about? Yeah. I mean, that sounds pretty crazy. But that's the way it was for me. And there were other kinds of experiences like that. And it was in that context that that we would find funny things. You know, of course, it's Christian context, so you got to be a little theological, right? You got to throw around your theological weight from time to time. And so oftentimes when we were in situations like this, we had this standard little phrase when something like that kind of ticked us off. And we didn't normally say it to an authority or to an adult, but we would say it kind of to each other in a joking manner. We'd go, listen, man, next time I see that RD, I'm just going to tell him, man, I'm under grace. I'm not under law, right? I mean, we're good Protestants here, right? We're under grace. We're not under this business of law. We know very well that this business of grace rules out any kind of real works on our part, and that goes for this as well. Well, I got upset one day because, guess what? I was walking to class, and RD caught me, and I was getting written up, going to have a demerit. And I just looked at him, and I said, Bill, what's your problem? Bill kind of looked at me like this right here, and I didn't stop when I really felt like I probably should have. I went ahead and uttered some other stupid things. And I said, Bill, listen, man, I'm not under law. I'm under grace. And Marty looked at me and he said, well, Chris, that may be where you are in terms of in God's scheme of things. He said, but I'm telling you this right here today, I'm all about the law. And you know what? Because you talked back to me, that's two demerits. And so he wrote me up on both cases. So two demerits on that particular day. You know, when we talk about this business of the gospel, grace, faith, the law, works, sometimes we think when we make little statements like that or when we make little justifications that when it comes to living out our salvation, that grace really is all that matters. And indeed, it does. It's that which enters us into this life of salvation. And it's purely not on our own merits. It's on the very merit of God, okay? That's clear. But sometimes when we engage and have those kinds of statements, it begins to develop an attitude in us that maybe this business of good works, maybe this business of following God's instruction in the law, maybe this business of actually living and being obedient to what Jesus teaches is really not as important as the grace part. You ever been there? It's really not as important as the grace part. It's almost as if obedience at times is kind of an afterthought. It's something that you get to in the Christian life if you get to it. It's kind of the fluff. Well, not the fluff, but it would be kind of the gravy, if you will, or the topping on the cupcake. Oftentimes, we wouldn't necessarily say it that way, but oftentimes in the way we approach the Christian life, sometimes the issue of obedience just seems to be optional in what God is really up to in our lives. You know, historical research in biblical studies over the past few years has sought to clarify this issue. How Jews and Christians within the first century of Jesus understood the relationship between things like law and gospel, grace, faith, and works. About 50 years ago now, a scholar by the name of E.P. Sanders at Duke University began to explore these issues, particularly whether the common assumption that Jews lacked an understanding of grace and were trying to earn their way to salvation through keeping the law. He wanted to explore that and see if it really had merit to it. Is this what they were doing? And so based on his reading of the primary sources, his general conclusion was actually that wasn't their assumption at all. That the Jews in the time of Jesus understood God's gracious salvation to be fully and totally wrapped up in his covenant with his people. And so keeping the law for Jews in the first century was not so much an attempt by Jews to earn their salvation, although it's very typical to hear that, but a way for Jews to maintain their covenant obligations in relationship to God. It's a different perspective, isn't it? You know, in addition to that, but more recently, the work of John Barclay, a scholar from the University of Durham in the United Kingdom, has explored the nature of grace. But he doesn't call it necessarily grace. He likes and prefers the word for gift. But this is where he goes with this. Rather than finding evidence of what is commonly understood to be the case, that the concept that we normally hold of pure grace excludes any notion of obligation on the part of the receiver of grace, Barclay begins to demonstrate that grace or gift in antiquity often carried with it the expectation of actual reciprocal behaviors and response. Both of these studies, Sanders and Barclay, they both suggest and bring greater clarity to really the symbiotic relationship in antiquity between what we refer to as the law and what we refer to as the gospel. And just this month, believe it or not, I got my book from a Baker academic. Yeah, on a related front, a new scholar by the name of Matthew Bates has published an important book that explores the fresh ways the dynamic relationship between faith, works, and the gospel of Jesus, the King, relate to one another. Drawing deeply on the biblical witness, Bates goes to great lengths in demonstrating that faith, or believing, is not mere mental assent. It's not what some call easy believism. No, Bates points out and demonstrates how faith is a covenant loyalty to God who saves his people through the Lord Jesus Christ. Covenant loyalty to God is what he means by faith. And so the notion of faith, as Bates goes on to argue in his book, is best understood as allegiance. As a matter of fact, he'll come back to name his book, Salvation by Allegiance Alone. Allegiance. This allegiance to embody and enact the kingdom vision of Jesus in all aspects of our lives. You know, based on these scholars, maybe, just maybe, gospel and law are not in reality as mutually exclusive as we once thought. Or at least maybe I thought in my college years. Maybe it's really a faithful kind of thing. Maybe grace, faith, and works are not meant to be understood as separate entities, but maybe they're seen to be an integrated whole in what God is really after in this business of salvation. Could it be? Well, let's not just take the word of Sanders and Barclay and Bates this morning. Let's actually go and see what Jesus has to say about such things. Let's listen to the words of Jesus this morning, chapter 5, verses 17 through 20. He says, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass away from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same, that one will be called least in the kingdom of heaven." That, by the way, basically means that you lose out on the kingdom of heaven. "But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven." You'll be able to participate in what God's doing in and through the kingdom. "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees," Jesus says, "you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Wow. Did you hear what he said? He said he came. The purpose of his life is not to abolish the kind of life to which the Old Testament law points. No, Jesus came to fulfill it, to complete it, to visually demonstrate the kind of life to which God's instruction focuses its gaze. That is, a life lived rightly with God, a life lived rightly with others, and a life lived rightly with the created order of things. And then did you hear what he goes on to say in this passage? When it comes to the law, everything in it is true, and everything in it will come to pass, Jesus said. This is Jesus. This isn't Sanders or Barkley or Bates. It's Jesus. All of it will come to pass. Also, only those who practice this life and teach others the whole of God's instruction will participate in God's kingdom. And further, the righteousness, or what we would call today the behavior that stems from the covenant that we make with God, this righteousness of a follower of Jesus, it must exceed the covenant behavior displayed by those in Jesus' day who were known for their strict piety and their own strict spirituality. The scribes, right? And the Pharisees. See, Jesus desired for God's kind of life to come alive in his people. This was central to the salvation that he understood and he taught. And so I say to you here this morning that obedience, according to Jesus, matters to God. And embodying this very kind of life is at the heart of what it means to participate in the kingdom of heaven. You know, interesting, in the immediately preceding passage, Matthew 5, 13 through 16, we find even greater grounding for the importance of obedience. More so, we gain greater insight into why obedience actually matters to Jesus and to God. And so what does Jesus do in this passage? He picks up on key Old Testament passages associated with God's calling upon his people, Israel. See, the people were living under God's promises to Abraham that they would be his people and that they would be a blessing to the nations. There was nothing special about God's people in and of themselves. What made them special is that God chose them for a special role that they would play in the redemption of the world. In the words of Old Testament scholar Craig Bartholomew, he says that on an international scale, Israel is called to be a display people, a showcase to the world of how being in covenant with Yahweh actually changes a people. As Israel obeys God, Bartholomew says, they will demonstrate what life under God's reign really looks like. The nations will be able to catch a glimpse of God's plan for all God's people as the whole of Israel's life experience reflects the holy character of God and his real intentions for human life. And in this way, Israel will fulfill the Abrahamic covenant to bless the nations. Faithfulness to the call to be a holy nation and a priestly kingdom is the way in which Israel will exercise her Abrahamic role in the world. Or in the words of Isaiah, one of Israel's great prophets in chapter 49, God has called his servant Israel to be a light for the nations so that his salvation might reach to the ends of the earth. Now, there's something interesting here that I want to point out about these chapters leading up to this quote from Isaiah in 49:6. In the preceding chapters, there's a sense that when God speaks about his servant, he has Israel in mind. But a shift takes place by the time we get to chapter 49, and here the servant seems not to be Israel, but a faithful representative who stands in the place of Israel. You know where I'm going with this. This chapter and those that follow speak about Jesus. No wonder in light of John's gospel, Jesus refers to himself as the light of the world. That's who God called Israel to be. But let's listen again to the words of Jesus this morning from Matthew 5:13 through 16. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underneath people's feet. You are the light of the world, a city set on a hill that cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket. No, they put it on a big old stand. That's my word there. A big old stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Do you notice how Jesus picks back up on this Old Testament theme of being a light to the nations? Yet now, do you notice how Jesus is not emphasizing how he's the light of the world? Who's the light of the world? The followers of Jesus. Those of us who take up the cross and follow after him. And notice how followers of Jesus are called to be this light. We're called to be this salt for the world. Not simply through our verbal proclamation, but through our behavioral demonstration of the glory of God. Listen to what Jesus says. Let your light shine before others, so that they may see your what? Good words? So that they might see your clean heart? Is that what Jesus says in this passage? What does he say? So that they might see your what? Your good works. And because they see your good works, they give glory to the Father. Moreover, notice how Jesus underscores the importance of their obedience in a word of caution. See, salt can lose its saltiness, and when it does, it's worthless. Light can be hidden under a basket, and it can fail to give off its intended light. Even so, followers of Jesus, when we fail to walk in obedience to Jesus, we can have a diminishing impact on the work of the gospel in the world. I'm going to say that again. When we fail to walk in obedience to Jesus, we can have a diminishing impact on the work of the gospel in the world. What's Jesus saying here? He's saying this, that our redeemed behavior has a purpose to play in God's grand redemptive scheme of things. It's not just a potential add-on to salvation. Our obedience itself bears witness to the glory of God and invites the nations to participate in his redemptive work in the world. I read a lot of books, and one that I read over the break, which is one that you ought to pick up, is one by another New Testament scholar by the name of Larry Hurtado. It's called Destroyer of the Gods. One of the things I love about the book is how it shows how the early Christian life within the early community in the first century was a very distinctive community. It's one that stood out against the backdrop of the Roman world. And one of the ways that it stood out was in its interesting kind of behavior. Listen to what he says about that. He says this. He says, Christianity insisted that its adherents behave differently in the world. Unlike the simple ritual observances characteristic of the pagan religious environment, embracing Christian faith meant a behavioral transformation with particular and novel ethical demands, especially, y'all ready? Especially for men in the first century world. He goes on to say that Christianity's novelty was no badge of honor. Its ethical teaching particularly bore some resemblance to the philosophers of the day, Yet in contrast, with these great teachers and their small circles of dedicated students, early Christianity laid its hard demands upon all adherents from the moment of conversion, producing a novel social project within the first century world. Y'all, I want to say this morning that Jesus believes in good works. Not in the sense of your good works meriting special favor with God, but good works that bear truthful witness to the transforming presence of God's Spirit in our midst and the redemptive work that God is accomplishing in Jesus for the whole world. To make good on his promise to Abraham to bless the nations, to set the whole world right again, to return all of creation to his blessed and beautiful kingdom vision for it. That's what God's up to in this business of salvation. Well, finally, in 5:1-12, in a very familiar passage to us, Jesus lays out a vision of God's good life for us. That is, the kind of life that God blesses and those to whom God graciously grants access to his kingdom. Interestingly, it looks a lot like the life of Jesus. Scott McKnight summarizes the 8 Beatitudes into 3. Those who are poor and humble. Those who pursue righteousness and justice, even at cost to themselves. And those who practice peace with others. Remember, this is that covenant behavior that we talked about earlier. That visible demonstration of the gospel. See, the people whose life together is characterized by this kind of covenant living, they're the ones who are truly blessed in God's scheme of things. For God's kingdom is available to these kinds of people, Matthew teaches us. There's so much more that we could say this morning about Jesus' kingdom vision as seen through the Beatitudes. But in conclusion this morning, let's listen one more time to the words of Jesus in verses 1 and 2 of chapter 5. Seeing the crowds, Matthew tells us, he went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. He opened his mouth and he taught them. That's what Matthew tells us here. Many of you have had the privilege of taking Introduction to the New Testament with Toby Grady, right? Or Kevin Burris. If you haven't, sign up. And you know that if you've taken that class, that there are 5 major discourses in Matthew's gospel dedicated to the teachings of Jesus. Much like Moses, Matthew presents Jesus as a gifted and authoritative teacher. As a matter of fact, at the conclusion of the Sermon on the Mount, we'll come back to this in about 4 weeks, in chapter 7, verses 28 and 29, Matthew says this, that when Jesus finished these words, the crowds were astonished at his teaching. He was teaching them, you see, on his own authority, Matthew says, not like their scribes used to do. One of the main reasons his teaching was so authoritative is because Jesus embodies his own teaching in every area of his life. He practices what he teaches and what he preaches. Remember, he fulfills. He lives the way God always intended his people to live, in covenant relationship with God, others, and creation. He lived in righteousness. Moreover, because he knows, Jesus is a faithful and able guide through the ongoing work of the Holy Spirit to help his followers to live into his kingdom vision in every area of our lives, so that the gospel is not just verbally proclaimed, as important as that is, but visibly displayed, bearing tangible witness to what God desires and is working redemptively toward in and for the sake of this world in which he loves and this world in which we live. As we close this morning, you know, it's very customary for us to talk and invite people to come to know Jesus as their Savior. And you know what? That is absolutely important because salvation begins there. But salvation also includes embracing and giving our ultimate allegiance to Jesus, not just as our Savior, but our ultimate allegiance to Jesus as our teacher. When we do so, God's Spirit begins to work with our obedience in such a way that God's kingdom is beautifully performed in and through our life together as his people. in these next few minutes, as we close with a song, I want to invite you to something particular this morning, in these next 3 minutes. There may be some of you here this morning that don't know Jesus as Savior. I'm not naive to think that maybe all of you do. Maybe this is the day where you've heard the call of the gospel and you want to give your life to Jesus. You want to know Him as Savior so that you can move on and to begin to give yourself and to know Him as teacher and to allow His life, man, to be manifested in and through yours. Maybe this morning, though, you've trusted Jesus as Savior, but you've not given your allegiance to Him as your teacher. And maybe this morning, the Holy Spirit has gotten a hold of your heart, and He's invited you to take the next step of the journey and to give your allegiance to Him as your teacher and to allow the Holy Spirit to so shape your life so that your life becomes to look like His. And in so doing, your life and our life together begins to bear witness and give glory to the redemptive God who's at work in this world to transform it and to make it what He desires it and claims it to be, and sets us all on a trajectory where we begin to live into the life that all of creation will one day enjoy. Life lived under the reign of God. Do you need to give your allegiance this morning to Jesus as teacher? As we sing this final song, I invite you to come to the altar and do this. And as we move throughout this Lenten season, continuing to have the opportunity to let Jesus to have His way so that His life becomes manifest in your life and in our life together. Will you stand? And for those who want to respond this morning, come.
Revive my heart, renew my life in every part. Reveal to me what sin remains, then lead me to cross again, restore my soul, revive my heart, renew my life in every part, reveal to me again.
The altars will remain open. If you want to just come and pray, if you want to give something in your life, submit it to the teaching of Jesus, and to give your life to being shaped into His image, to His kingdom vision for you and for us as a people. Jesus really meant it in the Gospel of John when He said, "I came that you might have life." Not just that you would be forgiven for your sin, but in and through the forgiveness of sin, you might have life. How might we give ourselves to Him in such a way during this Lenten season so He breathes new life into us, one that transforms our life together here as we live into His kingdom vision for us? As you go, think about such things, but even more so, give your allegiance to them. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.